Dearly beloved brethren, the Scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do, when we assemble and meet together, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying after me, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no helpless. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. And may the Almighty and merciful Lord grant unto you pardon and remission of all your sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips, and our joy shall show.
special welcome if you're visiting with us tonight. Basically, everything you need to know about the service you will find in the order for Sunday. You should have that with you. There are various points where you have to stand up and sit down. Don't worry too much about getting it right. And if you find it difficult to keep on your feet for long periods of time, you need to sit down. Please do feel free to do so. Speaking of guests, it's an special joy to welcome my colleague from Peterhouse, the Reverend Jennifer Adams Massman. Jennifer is the assistant chaplain at Peterhouse and welfare officer, and not that we're running some sort of American mafia here, but also an American, which I think is a good thing, by the way. And Jennifer, it's a delight to have you with us, and we look forward to hearing from you later. Also, please don't run away after the service. There is the opportunity for a glass of something, even though it's Lent, up in the old library. And if you don't know where the old library is, please just ask. The service continues with our Old Testament lesson.
The first lesson is taken from the 17th chapter of the book of Genesis, beginning to read at the first verse. And when Abram was 90 years old and 9, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. And I will make thee exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed ever after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee, and to be thy seed after thee. And God said unto Abraham, As for Sarai thy wife, thou shalt not call her name Sarah, but Sarah shall her name be. And I will bless her, and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her.
Thank you.
The second lesson is taken from the 8th chapter of the Gospel of St. Mark, beginning to read at the 31st verse. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected of the elders, and of the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he spake that, saying openly. And Peter took him, and began to rebuke him. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savourest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And when he had called the people unto him, with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Thus endeth the second lesson.
Thank you.
and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of thee, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And Almighty God, who seest that we have no power of ourselves to help ourselves, keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And all just works do proceed. Give unto thy servants the peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
More especially, we pray for the good estate of the Catholic Church, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in any ways afflicted or distressed, in mind, body, or estate, keeping a moment of silence where we may recollect before God those on our hearts. Father, may it please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Together we say the words of the promise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the gifts be with us all evermore. Amen.
May I speak and may you hear, in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Y2K fashion is back, and that means necklaces with crosses have also come back into fashion. Those of us alive a little while ago will remember that back in the early 2000s, everyone was wearing a cross. Hip-hop artists, Princess Diana, everyone had a big, bejeweled cross. This was the height of the fashion in the 90s and the aughts. A news reporter at the time interviewed a clerk in a department store in New York who explained that crosses, as she said, crosses are a fashion statement. And honestly, I'm a little low on crosses right now. They're flying out the door. One of my favorite cartoons, and from this time, shows two young women in tailored suits and designer handbags who are gossiping as they walk along the streets of New York City. A bearded Orthodox patriarch walks by them with a pectoral cross, and they yell out to him, "Fantastic crucifix, man." Now, recently, the New York Times ran an article about the resurgence of crosses as fashion after Princess Diana's famous amethyst Atala cross went in auction for a record-selling £160,000 purchased by influencer Kim Kardashian. Rihanna, Lizzo, Lourdes have all sported large, blingy, diamond-encrusted crosses at the Grammys or on the red carpet. Commenting on the current trend, one lecturer in jewelry design noted that people of all faiths or none were embracing them because, he says, we're now into charms with life-affirming attributes. Crosses are becoming part of that. Now that last sentence, as you might imagine, made me pause. Calling the cross a charm with life-affirming attributes is an interesting choice of words based on what we heard tonight in our gospel lesson. If you would be my followers, then deny yourselves and take up your cross and follow me. Now, many of us might be willing or happy to wear a cross today, but I suspect few of us would genuinely want to take up a cross and choose the suffering for which it stands. Then and now, the reality of the cross is scandalous. This idea shocked Jesus' followers as well, especially his close friend Peter. When faced with Jesus revealing that he would be persecuted and even killed, Peter balked. He straight out refused to let Jesus talk like that and took him aside for a little private talking to. How could Jesus' life and ministry be cut short now in such a humiliating way? Surely things are looking up for Jesus. He's healing, preaching, traveling. People are speaking well of him. Yes, some religious authorities are grumbling, but what of it? Surely, when they enter Jerusalem, Jesus will be greeted by crowds and embraced as the Messiah. How could he be so negative? What will that do for morale? Now, from our perspective, it's easy to assume that Peter is simply slow to grasp the radical implications of Jesus and the pushback that he will receive. But his words must have seemed reasonable to the other disciples as well, Peter's words. Jesus and his disciples had just entered the Roman city of Caesarea Philippi, a capital city built to celebrate the worldly power of Philip, son of Herod the Great, and to honor the emperor. And here Peter had just affirmed that Jesus is this Messiah, the one who is now to become the leader of Israel. Their hopes are high. Surely God has sent him, and he will save them not just from sin and illness, but maybe from Roman occupation, from corrupt government and other ills. We might wonder whether Jesus was moved by Peter's words, moved and hoped to believe that perhaps there was another way. He knows, after all, the voice of temptation when he hears it. He had faced the temptation in the wilderness, as we heard last week, the temptation every leader must face to choose power and popularity, relevance and reputation, to avoid rejection and pain and take the easier, the less dangerous path to worldly success on his own. He must have really tasted it, but he says no. We can almost imagine his voice trembling as he stands firm and rejects Peter's suggestion, calmly but firmly. Get behind me, Satan. If you are the Savior, save yourself, he would hear on the cross. And it's not that even now he can't save himself, but he won't save himself, because that's not who he is. Instead, he continues on the path he has chosen. Yes, the cross is his calling, but it is also his conscious choice, not just a one-time choice, but one he continues to affirm again and again. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their lives for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. These are hard words to hear, and even harder to live out. Wrestling with Jesus' words this week reminded me of the words of the great American satirist Mark Twain. Many people are bothered by those passages in Scripture which they cannot understand. As for me, he noted, I always feel that the passages in Scripture which trouble me most are those which I do understand. Self-denial and self-sacrifice go against the grain of all that we're taught to do in our competitive society. We want to set goals for success, to promote ourselves, to look to our own needs first. What is Jesus then calling us to do? First, we might actually need to clarify what it is he is not calling us to do, because this call to self-denial and self-sacrifice has often been misunderstood. On the one hand, sometimes it's been seen as meaning we should accept any kind of suffering passively. We should see all suffering as willed by God or inherently good. But this is not what Jesus' ministry or his preaching were clearly about. Second, Jesus is not blessing the status quo by saying that some groups of people, such as women or those who are disadvantaged, should accept their lot in life and they should make sacrifices, especially if those in power are not making the same sacrifices. We are not to be doormats or to fail to care for ourselves with wise boundaries in a way that is loving to us and others. So that distortion is important to clarify. But there are ways that we need to get out of our own way for the sake of something bigger and better. And the only one who has the right to call us to take up our cross is the one who takes up his own. Jesus did take up his cross because following any other path would not have been faithful to his calling. For with him, the kingdom of God is coming here on earth, here among us. That is the message of his life for which he is prepared to give it all. He lives and loves and dies like us, human and divine. And in his life and in his death, he embodies God's loving and transformative presence among God's people. As C.S. Lewis once wrote in The Problem of Pain, in the cross of Jesus Christ, God has paid us the intolerable compliment of loving us in the deepest, most tragic, and most inexorable sense. Knowing this means that we have the courage to carry the cross, because we know that in some sense the cross is carrying us. Because of his courage and his faithfulness, even death is no longer as frightening as it once was. Hope begins to burn in our hearts as God's love and forgiveness set us free. Filled with his mercy, we are finally able to stop grasping after worldly accolades or affirmation simply to justify ourselves or appease our anxious egos. Sometimes it is easy for us to be lulled into thinking that Christianity is just the beautiful churches that we have or the gorgeous music that we have, and we forget this radical call of discipleship for Christians, the kind of fine print, if you will. But as German 16th century reformer Martin Luther declared, a religion that gives nothing, costs nothing, and suffers nothing is worth nothing. Jesus reminds us that in the end it is much more costly not to take risks for the sake of him and his kingdom. We can only, after all, have it all if we are willing to give it all up. If we hold on to what we have fearfully and seek our own needs in isolation, we may make money or win awards or receive praise, but our lives will lack something, the depth and the joy that can only come when we take risks, when we open our hearts, when we give of ourselves and of our lives and talents and money, and make sacrifices that promote the well-being of others. In her book, Theology for Skeptics, the German theologian Dorothy Zola described this process of discovering in the scandalous message of the cross the way to true life. She wrote, "The more you grow into love, into the message of Jesus Christ, the more vulnerable you make yourself. You simply become more vulnerable to attack when that of God lights you up. When you spread your life around instead of hoarding it, then that great light becomes visible within you. To be sure, you may enter into loneliness. Often you lose friends, a standard of living, a job, or a secure career. But at the same time, you are changed. The cross, this sign of isolation, of shame, of abandonment, becomes, in this process, the tree of life, which you no longer want to be without at all, and you know at once where you belong." The film of Gods and Men, which came out about 10 years ago, illustrates what this vulnerability might look like. In it, we hear the story of a community of Cistercian monks who had lived peacefully with their neighbors in Algeria for decades until things began to change in the 1990s. The abbot Christian de Chargé had been a French soldier in Algeria back in the day, before he was a monk. And he always remembered that his life had been saved during an ambush by an Algerian Muslim man named Muhammad, a father of 10 children. And the next morning, Muhammad had been found killed. Christian de Chargé later wrote, "In the blood of this friend, I knew that my calling to follow Christ meant to live, sooner or later, in the country where it was given to me the greatest gift of love." So he returned to Algeria to live in this community. In the 1990s, however, with the rise of fundamentalist and jihadist groups, the situation for this monastic community that the abbot was leading became dangerous. They had to choose to stay or leave, knowing that staying might mean martyrdom. They wanted to stay in solidarity with their Christian and Muslim brothers and sisters in Algeria who were facing this terrorism and violence as well. The abbot, anticipating what might happen, wrote a letter to be sent to his friends and family if he were killed. "If it should happen one day, and it could be today, that I become a victim of terrorism, I would like my community, my church, and my family to remember that my life was given to God and to this country. I ask them to accept the fact that the one master of all life was not a stranger to this brutal departure. I could not desire this. It seems important to me to state this. Obviously, my death will appear to confirm those who hastily judged me naive or idealistic. Let him tell us now what he thinks of his ideals. For this life lost, totally mine and totally theirs, I thank God, who seems to have willed it entirely for the sake of that joy in everything and in spite of everything. Amen.
Set for this evening is number 380, and we omit the starred verses. 380 from the blue hymnal, omitting the starred verses. We stand. Blessing.